My name is Marco Lisi. I work for the European Space Agency and I was a former special advisor of the European Commission on Space Policies. And presently I'm also advising the European GNSS Agency, also called as, named as, known as GSA in Prague. At the moment, I'm working in the Navigation Directorate of the European Space Agency. As you probably know, since some years now, the European Space Agency, together with the European Union, European Commission, they started a big program on navigation, mainly two programs, EGNOS and Galileo. And so I presently work on Galileo, and my personal responsibility is that of developing the services of Galileo. So this is the reason why I'm supporting the European GNSS Agency. That agency is supposed to be the service provider of all the services of Galileo. And I try to support them really engineering. So I am actually developing a new branch of system engineering that I call, it's not, it exists in the world, but I'm developing it a bit in Europe, that is the service system engineering, where you focus not just on the development of a new system, but of the overall organization that is supporting a service out of that system. So I go a bit beyond, let's say, the bare technical level to look at problems that are in between technology and what sociology, and taking care of the human aspects of technology. How is the technology seen, used, perceived? How to measure things that are not technical or physical quantities? Because, for instance, at the end of the day, we want to develop systems to provide useful services. And we have users. Our real counterpart are the users, the final users. But how to measure, for instance, the satisfaction of a user? How to improve with an engineering approach the performance that the system provides to users? These are things that are somehow difficult, because we, as engineers, we are very clever in measuring kilograms, masses, or voltages, but when we have to measure something like the quality of a service, then we get into troubles. This is a general problem that will be more and more evident in our society. How to link the engineering world with the, if you want, social and economic world, and fit them together. I always make the example of the electric power distribution network. I don't know here in Bulgaria, but for instance, where I live these days in the Netherlands, in 5 years, I never experienced a breakdown of the electric power distribution network. So the electric power never failed in my at home. And we get very used to electricity. We think that it is there, we just plug in, okay? It is a real commodity. This is a real definition of commodity. We forget that behind the electric plug, there is a huge infrastructure that is more and more based, in fact, on information and communication technology. There are the network of for electric power distribution started being national, now is getting continental, and probably in the world, in the future, it will become worldwide. And these, all the local networks are connected together through computers, and they are synchronizing themselves. So behind the simple plug and the simple commodity, there is a huge technological effort. And in fact, this is the characteristic of the big, very advanced, technologically advanced service systems, what I call them service systems, because they are systems meant to provide a direct service to users. The more they are advanced technologically, more transparent they are to users. Users forget about them. So this has to be a change in perspective. In the past, engineers wanted to make their products visible. They wanted to make them complex. They spent so much time in developing them, and they wanted people to suffer a bit to understand. And we have to be, in the future, instead, to become such a good engineers that we make people forget about what they have done. And this is the perfection. The engineering perfection is when people forget about you and they just use your technology. So this is my personal view. And what this I'm trying to translate this vision of mine, in particular in the Galileo field, in supporting the development of the services at the European GNSS Agency. So I'm trying to conceive an organization that is more and more aiming at a service system that is so good that people will use it, forgetting about it. This is the future of technology, in my personal opinion. I started in 1980. Actually, my first employment was with IBM. I was hired immediately after graduating by IBM in Rome. I graduated in Rome. I got my doctor degree in Rome, and they hired me. And at that time, I thought I was very lucky. But I left after 2 or 3 months to go to an aerospace company. The name was Selenia. It doesn't exist any longer. It's now part of the Finmeccanica Group, to work on microwaves. That was a field that was not exactly that of my, but in fact, my thesis was on solar arrays, solar cells, a real technology, let's say, the ground technology of electronics, let's say, solid state electronics. Then IBM was a completely different field. I mean, of course, computers, etc. And then I moved back to something closer to physics and electronics, that was microwaves. And I started working there, and just by chance, I got involved in some projects for the European Space Agency. So it's really like, you know, the story of Charlie Brown. You know, there are some engineers from the European Space Agency saw what I was doing, and they found it interesting. In fact, out of one of the work, we got even a patent. It was my first patent at that time. And then they said, would you like to come? At that time, I was dreaming about going to the United States. They offered me to go to Holland. I said, okay, why not to go? And I went to Holland. So that was the beginning. Very soon I started working, let's say, almost from the beginning, in matters related to space. Developments of microwave components, filters, antennas, beamforming networks, that eventually were used in space applications. So the world has changed because really it's closer. I mean, languages are much more common. Everybody speaks English, at least, I would say. And now, to say that this is an improvement, it is surely an improvement because we have better chances to cooperate. And I like very much this the possibility to work with many companies everywhere in the world. But sometimes I feel that we have became a bit more superficial. So the culture, the average level of the culture has lowered a bit. There is less challenge. In my field, I keep saying that in aerospace and space, the two this type of industry suffers very much from the oscillations of the market. So since 1980, we experienced several going down, for instance, because of the fall of the Soviet Union, etc. And every time, especially in the space business, there is a shrinking of industries, many people leave or move to other areas. This is huge, you know, probably what happened in the former Soviet Union, you know, thousands of engineers became jobless. And so what happens, even in Europe, it happens that you lose a lot of know-how. In aerospace and space, the continuity of the know-how is essential, essential. So I think that one important objective also of an organization like Space Challenges should be to create a depository of know-how and to guarantee the continuity, to favor, as you are doing, the link between more experienced and younger people. Not because the more experienced the senior people are always better than the young people, but because it's important to guarantee some continuity. Of course, then the young people with their enthusiasm and the innovation can invent something, but not forgetting what it was done in the past. Otherwise, many times we discover, in Italian we say, the hot water. So we start from scratch again, and this is bad. You know, there are certain tricks and techniques that really you accumulate over the years, so you should not, let's say, lose them. And it takes years and years. One thing is for sure, when you destroy in an industry or in a country or in the experience accumulated over the years in space and aerospace, to rebuild it, it would take maybe 20 or 30 years. So sometimes you get out of the business forever. Okay, so it is very important to guarantee the continuity of the know-how. I am fascinated in general about knowledge and technology, let's say, associated to technology. But what I have been, also because of my background, that is in fact classical, because I made the classical studies, I studied Latin, Old Greek at school. More and more I also realized that to be a good engineer and to develop a truly useful technology, you should not forget about the, well, let's call it the humanistic side of our life. So we should never forget that whatever, and this in my view is well synthesized in one specific period in the history of the world, that was the Renaissance. In Renaissance we had the best and never seen before and after scientists and engineers, think of Leonardo, just to mention one, but those people were also artists. So Leonardo was a top scientist and top inventor, top technologist, but he was also top painter and top musicians even. So these people, those people didn't find any difference between technology, science, and all the other aspects, because we are one. I mean, not forgetting that the knowledge is one. There is no such a thing as knowledge in literature and knowledge in, it's only one, because we as human beings are one and not many things, different things. We should never forget that. So it's bad that engineers sometimes get too specialist, and because in doing that and forgetting about other aspects of our human life, they also forget about the ultimate objective of what they do, that is to be useful. And engineers, as even a scientist, because to pursue knowledge is also useful for the humankind at the end. Humankind needs to pursue knowledge. Okay, engineers, if you want, they have a further burden that is to make knowledge useful in everyday life. This is another challenge of their own. And they should never forget about that. Otherwise, they are just technicians, the people that pursue just technology per se. Technology per se is nice, but not enough. I think, again, the future always, in all fields of technology, and specifically in global navigation systems, ask for more and more integration, because our world gets more and more integrated. And the sophistication of our society asks for integration. We have today whatever we use in our technology is in fact the result of an integration. We have our smartphone, is the integration of the computer technology, the communication technology, the radio frequency technology. So now you get through your smartphone applications never thought before, like you can get pictures from Google Earth about the situation everywhere in the world. So the future ask to get close to the final users, to the people, technology needs a further integration. So the future I see in global navigation satellite systems that it has to get more and more integrated, for instance, with telecommunications, with Earth observation, because at the end, the final application for the user, to speak in terms of apps, let's say, is the one that gives him answers. It doesn't need the position, or it doesn't need, you don't need to know your latitude and longitude. You need to go safely from here, for instance, to the airport. But to go safely to here from the airport, you don't need only the directions, but you need to know, for instance, what is the traffic, if your airplane is late or not. If it is late, you can relax, maybe you take the bus and you leave your car at home. So this is the true, let's say, evolution of technology. That technology takes care of you, merging together many other type of information and data. Well, of course, I am afraid of a technology that is losing sight of the human aspect of life. I am very worried about being superficial in technology, in other words, to develop spots of technology that do not merge one with the other. So the risk is that we reach top level of sophistication, but then we are not able to put things together. And this is also very bad. Or another big risk in the future is that of forgetting about the use of our hands. At the end, we have to experiment. Okay, the big lesson from people like Galileo is that you should never, let's say, it's not only theory, but it's also experiment. And from theory and experiment together, you go on. And some people now, for instance, what I really find very dangerous, that people use simulation, abuse of simulations, where they think that simulation is the reality. Simulation is not the reality, it's a way, a tool to understand and to develop something about the reality. But at the end of the day, you really have two things. And what you do proves whether your theory is correct or not, your simulation was usable or not. Simulation per se doesn't change the world. Okay? So this is important. So I'm a bit afraid that people do lose the fascination of realizing things. I always use to speak about products, to speak about systems, to speak about services. Now, products are the individual piece of hardware, software that you might develop. You put them together, you might have a nice system, but still it is more of on the technical, technological side. It's only when this system is supported by an organization, by a vision, and maybe speaks with other systems, that you really solve the problem and then you provide the service. Okay? If you want to resolve the problem of transportation here in Sofia or wherever, it's not enough to have many parking areas, good cars. You might have good cars, you might have parking areas, you have good public transportation, but you do not solve the transportation problem. Transportation problem must be an enterprise, an organization that think of all the relations and find the solution for the overall problem. So the impact on economics can be huge. We can become much more effective. We can make better use of our resources. And unfortunately, even in terms of resources, the resources are getting somehow scarce. So we have to be very careful. So we have to be smart and effective to resolve the economical and social problems of the future. I am optimist, but I think that we have to fight and work very hard. So I'm optimist about the future and about the impact of technology. I'm not optimist about getting, let's say, an easier life, professional life. I think our professional lives must be get tougher and tougher. It is part of the game, if you want, and to some extent I like it. I never relaxed in my professional life. I think that we should not. I think knowledge and profession ask for dedication. So you have to dedicate yourself. You do not have to kill yourself. You also have to spend time to read good books, literature. That is part of professionalism, as I said before. But you never relax, okay? And we have to fight, fight, fight. So if that is being optimist, then I am optimist. But some people will not like what I say. They do not have to relax. Very little. I think that I was just thinking about coming here to Bulgaria. I was reading something and also thinking. For instance, I was thinking that we are from Rome. We are very close, in fact. We are closer, Sofia is closer to Rome than what Rome is close to Amsterdam. So I just said before that for me to go from Amsterdam to Rome is really like taking a taxi. And so then, again, it's a challenge, but should realize quickly that we have to favor the merging of cultures. By the way, we have, and this I knew and I studied a bit before coming, we have a lot of history in common from the old times of Romans, etc. There were some intermediate periods where, unfortunately, we lost track of each other, but I believe very much in the concept of Europe. Not very much the Europe we have today. I think that we should improve it a lot, but the concept of Europe as a common heritage in culture and past history is there, and we are really around the corner. So I hope very much, and I like to see that some Italian colleagues are working here at Space Challenges, etc. I find it wonderful, just wonderful. And the same is knowing that people like you or other studied in Italy as they studied in the United States. I think the world has to get closer, but first of all, Europe has to get closer and closer. I think innovation is more a matter of mental attitude. I don't think it is, and I do not think that if you also look at the good examples of areas where, in fact, there is a lot of innovation, think of Silicon Valley. I worked myself for many years in the Silicon Valley. I found that there is no specific reason why that area was so innovative. There was no, it was not a matter of laboratories, or I think it was again a matter of the mental attitude of the people. If you study the story of the biggest technological corporations like Hewlett and Packard, really go back to what? To two individuals, in fact, students, fresh students at Stanford University that started in a garage. You go to Palo Alto, there is still the garage of Hewlett-Packard. So everything starts from emotion, passion, of course, with, you know, who was the professor of Hewlett and Packard? A certain Terman. Terman, one of the biggest electronic engineers in the history of the United States, of the world. And of course, when you have a good teacher, then, but it starts with the individuals, really. And so innovation is not a prerogative of one region or one country. It's a matter of culture. A culture must become innovative. I would suggest that they are very open-minded, ready to work very hard, because the world is becoming more and more competitive. To be open to Europe, in general to the world, in the sense ready to move, but not necessarily to leave Bulgaria. I think they can move to make the, to get the information and education, but then hopefully getting back, why not? Whatever they like, let's say, yeah? They'll find their way in this world, but without excluding remaining in Bulgaria, but very open-minded. It's important to be open-minded, to feel somehow really citizens of Europe first and somehow also citizens of the world. And with this vision, also to keep their mind open to all aspects of life, not just being a technician. I mean, again, learning how to become professional, keeping their mind open, ready to work hard. Okay, I think it's enough. It should be enough. It's not an easy life, but can be interesting. I think I found it interesting so far, so I hope that it will be interesting also for them.